who's a PhD student in development studies, and he'll be talking about giving an introduction to Schumpeter and Schumpeter's views on capitalism. And José will be talking for about 40 minutes, and then we'll have about 10 minutes at the end for questions. So please welcome José.
Thank you, Ida, and thank you all for coming. As Ida told you, today I'm going to present a brief introduction to the work of Joseph Schumpeter, particularly his conception on capitalism. I think that, first of all, CSEP has been doing a very good job with these paper zero lectures, and not only with the paper zero, but with a series of seminars that you've been running in order to make a critique, not only to the economy today, but to the most flagrant blind spot in contemporary economic thinking. So I'm very happy to be here trying to help a little bit to that goal. I think that the first question in order to understand Schumpeter's conception of capitalism should be why to read Schumpeter? You know, like, why should we read nowadays this 20th century economist? I mean, of course, like the normal answer would be because Schumpeter appears in every textbook on macroeconomics, you know, in this typical textbook where this like few paragraph on the most important economist. So for general knowledge, it should be interesting to know a little bit about Schumpeter. But the key question is, does Schumpeter tell us something about developing a critical perception of the economy today? Does Schumpeter tell us something about how to put some light, as I said, to the blind spots of contemporary economic reasoning? And I think, yes. You know, and the question actually is very interesting because can we learn something from this very elitist, conservative, patriarchal, with very weird opinions about the Third Reich, this very arrogant economist? You know, there is this anecdote that once Schumpeter, when he was very old, he said, I had three goals in my life. The first one was to be the best economist in the world. The second one was to be the best lover in Europe. And the third one was to be the best horse rider in Austria. And with melancholy in his eyes, he told his friends, unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to do the last one. You know, I simply couldn't do it. So what can we learn from this Joseph Alois Schumpeter, this conservative guy that was Ministry of Finance of a socialist government? And then he was kicked out because he was into kind of illegal things, you know? And I think there is a lot to learn from this character. What can we learn from Schumpeter? You know, Wolf von Stolper, a famous economist, he with Paul Samuelson developed this famous Stolper and Samuelson model on international trade, an evolution, you know, of the Hecker and Holling model. He was also a student of Schumpeter, and he even wrote the biography of Schumpeter. And he said, the greatness of Joseph Schumpeter are not in this idea or this other idea. The greatness of Joseph Schumpeter lies in his general view on capitalism. If you want to understand his deep perception about economics, you should take like his big picture, the big perception that he had on the evolution of capitalism. And I think that is what I will try to do today. We'll try to explain you his big picture. And I think that in order to explain you like the big picture of Schumpeter's perception on capitalism, we should, and sorry the analogy, we should talk a little bit about Darwin. Schumpeter read a lot of Darwin, you know? And before Darwin, our understanding of species and life was static and essentialist in nature. At that time, we thought that species were given by some exogenous variable, let's say God. And the complexity and the structure of the species was static and stationary. The structure of our body, the structure of a species in general, were just given without capacity to change. And it was the brilliant capacity of Darwin, the most beautiful discovery ever, probably, that he said, no, the most important characteristic of life is its capacity to change. You know, its capacity to change from within. Certainly, the previous way of understanding life were very important. It helped us to understand the structure of a species, but they missed a key point, that life has this capacity to evolve, to change from within. And he developed new theoretical tools. He developed new concepts, evolution, selective adaptation, and so on. He developed a new paradigm in order to understand what the previous way of knowledge could not detect, that was the capacity of life to change. And I think Schumpeter, he read Darwin, he tried to do something similar, but with a certainly less glamorous and less complex object of study, that is life. He tried to understand the same dynamic about a particular social organism, that is the capitalist civilization. And he made a very similar critique. He said, the previous way of understanding capitalism, what he defined as the marginalist perception, the Walrasian general equilibrium theory, the circular flow that I will explain to you now, that perception of capitalism is certainly important and it's certainly useful, permit us to understand the relationships between quantities and prices. But that way of knowing things could not help us to understand the most important characteristic of capitalism, that is its capacity to change. So we have one point that is interested in Schumpeter that I will explain. His understanding of capitalism as a machine that changes. And second, the incapacity of the ways of knowing economics, of the neoclassical school, of understanding, of grasping that perception of capitalism as a dynamic machine. Okay, the first point. The second point that Schumpeter did was to say, in order to understand capitalism and in order to understand economics, we should also open the door for alternative disciplines. We should open the door for the study of sociology and history. He even said, the good economist is the economist that has a clear knowledge about economic theory, sociology, history, and statistics. And by knowing that, those disciplines, you will get a deep understanding of the way that economy works. And by doing that, when he began to read and understand other disciplines, he reached another conclusion. Remember that I told you, capitalism as a dynamic machine. But he reached another, and from his perspective, more pessimist conclusion, that capitalism is self-destructive. That capitalism has not only a capacity to change, but it's building the sources of its own suicide. Okay? So we have three quite interesting ideas that we find in Schumpeter. Capitalism as a dynamic machine, the necessity to include other disciplines in order to grasp the most important characteristic of capitalism, and the third one, the idea that capitalism is destroying itself. Does that remind you Marx? Certainly. But the conclusion, even though they're very similar, comes from different means. I mean, the way that Schumpeter understood the self-destructive characteristic of capitalism is totally different from Marx, and we will see how. Those three ideas are the one that I will try to explain to you. And the way that Schumpeter reached those conclusions, I think, will help us to understand a little bit more or in a better way the key concept of Schumpeter's view of capitalism. In 1928, Schumpeter wrote a very interesting article called The Instability of Capitalism. In this article, it was 1 year before the financial crisis, you know, it's very interesting. Well, in that article, he said, if you want to understand the capitalist regime, you have to make an analytical distinction between what he called the economic system and the economic order, okay? The economic system, according to Schumpeter, is nothing more than the relationship between quantities and prices in a market. It's what is traditionally the object of a study of economists, the relationship in a market of supply and demand and the equilibrium towards one particular price. Think about the market in the abstract sense, without any exogenous variable, without like political institution and so on and so on. This is like, as I said, the object of study of economics, traditionally understood. But Schumpeter said there is another sphere, a broader one, what he called the economic order. This economic order refers to the habits of thought, the culture, the political institution that are the pillars for the reproduction of the market. If you read Polanyi, this is like the market economy and its institutional embeddedness. Marx would have defined it as the relationship between the economic base and the political superstructure. The point is the same, that around the market there are these extra economic institutions that are the supports that permits the reproduction of the economy, these extra economic variables. According to Schumpeter, this is very interesting, if the object of study of economy, economist, is the economic system, the object of study of political economy is the interaction between these two fields. And in this sense, political economy is a broader discipline, okay? So, according to Schumpeter, this should be like the real unit of analysis if you want to understand capitalism. You should start by these two fields of analysis, two spheres, okay? What I will try to do is to explain you first the way that according to the neoclassical economics, the system works, and the critique that Schumpeter did toward that understanding about how the economic system works, okay? And in the second part, I will try to explain how, according to Schumpeter, the economic system and the economic order are like related. And you will see that the way that they are related is a contradictory and self-destructing relationship, okay? So, at the time of Schumpeter, and unfortunately up to now, I think, the way that the economists understood the economic system was in a very easy way. It was, imagine an isolated society with free exchange of commodities, with free contract, with property, the word, very well-established institution of property. Okay, that typical idea of the market and people exchanging with two agents, the producer and the consumer. And in this society, the capitalist, the producer, is a passive agent, and the consumer is the active agent, is the sovereign agent in that game. The consumer is the one that through its demands establishes what is going to be produced in a society. And the capitalist, as a manager, just receives that input, that demand, and transforms it into an output, a commodity. Okay, so we have two agents. The consumer is the sovereign, like just like in liberal democracy, you know, people say that the citizens are the sovereign. In this kind of economy, the consumer is the sovereign agent, and the capitalist is the passive one. In this society, we have one rationality. We have the homo economicus. You know, the consumer just wants to maximize their utility expressed as an extension of the capacity of consumption, and the capitalist wants to maximize their utility expressed as an increase in their pecuniary profit. We have two agents, one rationality, okay? At the same time, the amount of money in that economy is just the necessary money available in order to keep the flow of commodities. That's the third point. And the last point is that this system is a repetitive and a static system. As capitalists just produce what the demand is saying, and demand doesn't change radically from one day to another, since consumption is nothing more than the emergent property of culture, and culture does not change from one day to another, and the changes then are just marginal, then this system is just a circulation of commodities, a tautology. Do you follow me? It's the same commodity, and it's the same demand, and in the same way of producing. It's also static in nature, in the sense that the economy is seeking an equilibrium towards one particular price. Think about, the best way to think about it is the way that Schumpeter thought. Think about the circulation of blood in an organism. It's repetitive, it's static, it's always like following the same path, okay? If we agree on that, we will find like a very clear scenario of certain key agents exchanging commodities. However, that approach, the famous circular flow of commodities, or the general equilibrium, as Walras might have called it, it was very interesting, it was very efficient in order to answer one question, how prices and quantities are related. Okay, and that is a very important point, you know. And Schumpeter was very in favor of that. I mean, Schumpeter admired Walras for achieving that scientific discovery of finding scientifically the relationship between prices and quantities. However, that approach was not able to detect one thing, and it's probably the most beautiful thing of capitalism, its capacity to change. Its capacity to constantly transform the productive structures. Its capacity to develop the forces of production. It's the same thing that Marx said when he wrote with Engels the Communist Manifesto. He said, one of the most virtuous characteristics of the bourgeois civilization is that all solids melt into the air. A very beautiful metaphor. Referring that in the bourgeois civilization, all the given patterns of production are destroyed by the capitalist competition. And they produce new ways of producing things. This is exactly what Schumpeter defined as innovation. According to Schumpeter, one of the characteristics, the key characteristic of capitalism, was its capacity to constantly discover new goods, new markets, new productive structure, new units of production. Okay? These four points, and also the new ways of organizing the firms, this innovative characteristic of capitalism could not be understood by the marginalist, by the neoclassical approach. That is the first point that he makes. And if that is true, neoclassical economics is good in order to understand one point, the equilibrium of prices, but is unable to understand the key points, the evolution and the transformation of capitalism. And here Schumpeter makes a very interesting distinction between economic growth and economic development. Economic growth, according to Schumpeter, refers to an economic that is able to like growth determined by exogenous variable, changing the population, changes in the patterns of consumption, changes in like certain like new consumption desires and so on. It's exogenous variable that influence the equilibrium. Changes in this exogenous variable creates a new equilibrium, and that's way of growing the economy is what he defined like as economic growth. However, there is another way of economic growth. That is what he defined as economic development. And economic development refers to a kind of economic growth that changes from within. It's not dependent on some exogenous variable, but has this capacity to create new equilibrium, new way of producing things without the influence of exogenous variables. When Schumpeter gave the book, his theory of economic development, to Walras, he went with 28 years old to the house of Walras, and he said, "Here's the book. You know, like I would like you to sign it to write something." And Schumpeter asked Walras, "How can you explain economic change?" And Walras said, "No, it's not the object of economists to explain economic change. The market is nothing more than the passive institution that receives the influence, the extra economic influences, and just adapt into new commodities or new equilibrium." Do you follow me? So according to Walras, economic change was something exogenous to the capitalist system. And it's exactly that what Schumpeter was criticizing, Walras and the marginalists and the neoclassical economists. And by the way, like as another anecdote, Walras gave the book to Schumpeter. He said, like, "Well, tell many thanks to your father about like offering me this book." And Schumpeter said, no, I wrote the book." And Walras said, no, you couldn't have written that book. I mean, you're very young." And then he starts saying like, "Oh, these young people, they're always trying to get popular, you know, inventing things." Well, but that was like the most critical, the first critique that Schumpeter did to neoclassical economics. If that is true, and if neoclassical economics does not have the capacity to explain change, how can we explain change? How can we explain change without recurring, bringing in these exogenous variables? Where can economic change come from? Where in the circular flow? We have consumers, we have producer, we have the exchange of goods and services, and we have given money that is just the necessary for the circulation of commodities. Could economic change come from consumer? Certainly not. Consumer desire things that are already there. They don't desire things that doesn't still exist. I mean, there was no a person demanding before the existence of the chewing gum, demanding like to chew something during the whole day, you know? It's impossible. So consumer did not have the interest or the capacity to even think about new commodities. I desire what is already in the market. Could then economic change come from the capitalist, since they are the owners of the means of production, they have the, in principle, the capacity to decide where to invest and where not to invest? Certainly not. Capitalists are rational agents. They try to avoid risk. They try to satisfy the demand. Their competition is through prices. There is no interest in taking such a big risk in building this possible commodity that could satisfy like the future consumers. Then the question is, where does economic change come from? Certainly, it cannot come from the circular flow as it is expressed here, since profits are actually very low, since the competition is through prices and it's a free economy, the surplus of profits tend to go down. At the same time, the available money is just for the circulation of commodities. There are no surplus in purchasing power in order to make the long-term investment necessary for innovation. Where does it come from? And Schumpeter tells us there is one missing agent in this model. That is the entrepreneur. Here's the producer, the capitalist, and the entrepreneur. And this agent, actually it's not an agent. The entrepreneur is not a class. It's not like the capitalist, the labor, or the landlord. The entrepreneur is a function. You can be an entrepreneur during part of your life and then become a manager, or then become capitalist. It's a way of building new ideas, it's a way of building new commodities and building new markets. It's a capacity that certain people have. And this is even more interesting because what drives the entrepreneurs? What is the motive of the entrepreneurs to take this risk in new commodities and new markets and new process of production? According to Schumpeter, the conventional view of the homo economicus, the rational agent, you know, like fighting for prices and so on, is unable to understand the logic and the psychology of the entrepreneur. The motive of the entrepreneur, according to Schumpeter, is not profit per se. It's not satisfying the consumer. It's, and this is the word that Schumpeter used, building a private kingdom, having this like capacity of conquer, this spirit of putting your name in a market, you know, in a product, destroying the competition, building an intuition that there is a potential market for a product. It's a completely different psychology what drives the entrepreneurs. It's totally different from the capitalist just fighting for like satisfying the demand. It's an active agent and not a passive one as the capitalist in the circular flow. Okay, so it's a totally different a psychology, totally different from the homo economicus, totally different from Adam Smith's perception of the capitalist, and certainly if you're interested in sociology, from the Weberian idea of capitalist as this rational agent. This entrepreneur enters into the circular flow, but where does the money come from? Okay, we have an agent that has some interest in innovating. Where is the money? And according to Schumpeter, the most important characteristic of capitalist society is the private financial system. While for Weber, for example, the most important characteristic is the rationalization of life, for Marx is the production of surplus value, for Schumpeter, the most important characteristic is the existence of private banks. Why? Because private banks have this capacity of building purchasing power out of nothing. Their function is to create money, to create available money for entrepreneurs. So we have and this is putting money into the circular flow. And not only that, it's not only putting money, but it's democratizing the access to credit. It's not that the available money is in the hands of feudal lords, or in the hands of the state, or in the hands of like some pre-capitalist statute groups. It's a money that is available for anyone that can have a good idea in order to innovate. So there, according to Schumpeter, the financial system is an institution that democratizes society. Of course, nowadays, we can have a little doubts about that, but he was very positive about this key element of the capitalist society. If you want a critique to this perspective, you will find it in Hilferding's Financial Capital. He makes a totally different perspective and talk about the oligopoly and the alliance between the industrial capitalist and the financial capital and the capacity to put down innovation, actually. But that is Schumpeter's idea. So we have entrepreneurs, we have the credit system, so we have the agent for innovation and the income in order to innovate. How does this work? According to Schumpeter, the entrepreneur wants to build a private kingdom, wants to put the family name. He was also very interested in the business and its families, you know, want to put a name in the market. And the profit, where does it come from? According to Schumpeter, the profit of the entrepreneur is what he defined as the monopoly rents, as monopoly rents. If you create a new product, you are the only supplier of that commodity. You are actually a monopoly. There is no competition since you are the first one to put that commodity in the market. So you have extra profits, certainly above the profit that you can have from the circular flow, from just the competition through prices. You are competing through the differentiation of products. Okay? So you have first of all, the entrepreneur, here, and this creates an innovation, and this creates a monopoly profit. It creates huge amounts of profits, right? And this makes, this process of building a monopoly rent is very interesting because it has an impact on the capitalist elite. Because if you build a new product, and if you are able to destroy the previous capitalist, you are becoming a capitalist. You are becoming a dominant class. The previous families and the previous capitalists are going down. They cannot compete with the new entrepreneur. And the entrepreneur becomes the dominant class. And when it becomes a dominant class, it becomes a manager. See, the dialectic here is beautiful. You know, the entrepreneur becomes a typical capitalist manager and start competing through prices. And it's very obvious because monopoly prices attract followers. If there is a new product that is creating a huge amount of profit, people are going, producers and capitalists are going to go to that market and start competing, right? And through that competition, monopoly rents are going to start going down. And they are going to enter again in the circular flow, OK? And in this sense, innovation is this dialectic, is that constant interrelation between trying to be a monopoly and entering back into the circular flow through the forces of competition. So we have monopoly rent, and then the followers, and then goes back to the circular flow and the competition through prices. And this creates new entrepreneurs trying to fund new sources of monopoly rents and private kingdom and so on and so on, and a new tautology and a new circulation, not only of new product, but also in a new circulation of elites. And this is how Schumpeter explained the circulation of elites. Certainly, there is always one capitalist class, but the people that are in this capitalist class are always changing. And this is how, in a brief summary, Schumpeter explained economic change from within, without some exogenous variable, without changing in patterns of consumption, without political conflicts, without changing in the international situation, just changes from the own capitalist system. However, this has an impact on the economic order, on the institutions, on the state structure, on the culture about that economic system. Schumpeter said that in the period of competitive capitalism, the economic system was very unstable. It was always changing, always the elites were circulating, always new product and so on and so on. But it produced economic order. The innovation, the process of innovation, creates new elite. And these new elites were able to justify their elite position by saying, we were able to innovate, we were able to create new goods, and we deserve to be rich. So you have an agent that is supporting capitalism, the dominant class, but at the same time, you have a society that accepts the dominant classes because actually they are supporting innovation. So ideologically and culturally, that system, that capitalist instability, is creating an unstable political order. We can go back in the question about this. But the key question is that capitalism is not only this. Capitalism also evolves towards the monopolization, towards the trustified capitalism. As innovation is all also through the units, through the productive units tend to become more big in order to take advantage of the scale economies and start producing this process of what Marx would have defined as the concentration and centralization of capital. Big capitalists that are eating, are destroying, are expropriating the small and medium bourgeoisie. And this process creates two things. First of all, the big monopolies, and second of all, the destruction of one social strata that is always, that has been always supporting capitalism, the small and medium enterprise that have this idea about property, that they defend free competition. They have ideologically committed with capitalism. So this process of monopoly capitalism is, first of all, destroying the small and medium capitalists. Second of all, this process of capitalist rationalization, this process of capitalist controlling the forces of the economy, is also destroying one particular strata, the aristocracy, the old feudal lords. And according to Schumpeter, and this is very interesting because it goes against Marx, the aristocracy is not the enemy of the bourgeoisie, it's its most important ally. The aristocracy and the feudal lords and all that strata have this capacity, according to Schumpeter, to be politically active, to control things, to build this culture of hierarchy, of order, of custom, and traditions that are able to support the capitalist competition. And most importantly, are able to support the workers' commitment to the productive order. And by destroying capitalism, those good old friends, the aristocracy and lords and their culture, they are building a process of rationalization, of problematization and politicization of the productive structure. So capitalism destroyed the small and medium enterprises, capitalism destroyed its allies, the feudal lords, and also, according to Schumpeter, capitalism destroys the own capitalist, the own bourgeoisie, in the sense that with the emergence of the big firms, innovation is not an individual action. Innovation is not like, I have an idea, I go to the market, I compete, and I become like a capitalist, you know, through my success. But innovation now becomes an impersonal process that is within the monopoly, is within the firm. You know, like nowadays, every firm has this department of innovation. So innovation is not anymore a thing of the capitalist or the entrepreneur competing in the market, but it's a bureaucratized process. It's people that are like hired, they're workers, the ones that are innovating. So according to Schumpeter, those new ways of innovation are not linked with the bourgeoisie and its culture anymore, and are linked with the hierarchy, with centralism, and with workers' ideology. And this process of the change of the way that innovation is done destroys not only the individual innovator, entrepreneur, but also destroys the ideology behind him or her. That is, that through market competition, you are going to be able to succeed. So destroys aristocracy, destroys small and medium enterprises, destroys the role, the capitalist role of the entrepreneur, but also destroys the capitalist. And this is what a very important and very good economist that I recommend you to read, like Thorsten Veblen, he would define it as the absentee ownership. In modern capitalism, the capitalist is not, of course, anymore the owner of the firm that is committed to the productive order, you know, it's there in the firm, but is nowadays financialized. You know, it's nothing more than a shareholder of the firm. So the capitalists are nothing more than people that are in the financial system that don't have any connection with the productive order. So they don't have any commitment with the sustainability of that productive order. So they stop defending capitalism, according to Schumpeter. So we have like a whole, through the process of innovation, a whole process of destruction of the economic order. The elite is being destroyed by its own forces. And even more, as the culture of hierarchy and custom and tradition are not there anymore, workers become politicized and start demanding new rights, more participation, and so on. So you have this beautiful capacity, this beautiful antinomy, this beautiful contradiction, that is a system that is building a worker and a politicized worker class, and at the same time is building a capitalist class or the dominant class without any kind of interest in supporting its own regime. And the last solution, according to Schumpeter, is socialism. Socialism understood as bureaucracy. Socialism understood as the state control of the means of production and so on. Of course, we can talk about this because I don't know, of course he was not, unfortunately, right about that. But certainly it tells us about the contradiction that Schumpeter is telling us about the system and the order. And as a conclusion, and I'm concluding here, if in the competitive capitalism, the economic system is unstable, it's always changing, it's always competition, new elites, new people with innovation, and so on and so on, and the economic order is stable, in the period of monopolized capitalism, the things are the other way around. The economic system is very stable since innovation is part of the firm. It's not outside, you know, it's not someone trying to destroy a family, a capitalist family, and so on. It's endogenous now, the innovation within the firm, it's part of the firm. So it's not as like challenging as it used to be. But it's the economic order that is unstable. So there is, according to Schumpeter, a contradiction in capitalism and the capacity of capitalism to be destroyed by its own forces, not because of economic reasons. And this is the distinction with Marx. Marx said, it's capitalism through the falling of the rate of profit that is going to create the economic condition for its own destruction. No, Schumpeter would say, the problem is not in the economy, the problem is in the impact of that process of capitalist innovation in the culture, in the legitimation of its own system. And I think this is like one of the most a strange conclusion of a person that is supporter of capitalism, a very conservative person that is saying the system that I adore is going to be destroyed by its own forces. So we have reached the following points. I try to show briefly that capitalism is a source of dynamism through the forces of the entrepreneur that destroy the circular flow and try to create the monopoly rents, trying to build this private kingdom. And second of all, that this source of innovation in the long run and through the process of trustification, of monopolization of capitalism, is creating certain contradiction and certain tension that in the sphere of culture is going to destroy it by its own forces. So I think I'm in the perfect time. So I hope that you're going to have many questions. Thank you.
Can you clarify what you mean by when you say neoclassical economists don't really take into account economic evolution?
Yeah. Well, according to Schumpeter, like within the Walrasian approach, at least the conventional, typical neoclassical approach, is unable to understand how economic change, because the capitalists compete, according to the premise of neoclassical economists at that time, compete through prices. They try to put prices as far down as possible in order to gain the demand. But they are unable, according to Schumpeter, to explain that approach of things, that vision of the capitalists, that the homo economicus, that through the rational decision try to put prices down and not taking the risk for new innovations. That vision of things are unable to explain where does innovation come from. Because look at this, the capitalists, according to the neoclassical approach at that time, wanted to take low risk and big profits and compete through prices, okay? And at the same and in that scenario, how can the capitalists think about building a new product that is so risky in the long run? No, even in the short run, it's very risky to create a new product. There should be another psychology behind it that at that time the neoclassical approach did not create. It was assuming this perfect rational agent. And the characteristic of the entrepreneur is actually that it's not rational, it's moved by intuition. This is quite similar to what Keynes was talking about when he talked about the animal spirit. So it's a different psychology what moves the entrepreneur and the capitalist. And is this like psychology goes beyond the maxima, the utility maximizer agent that is one of the core assumptions of neoclassical economics.
But then how would the neoclassical economists understand like Ricardian comparative advantage then? Because doesn't that take a certain amount of innovation in a way? Is that like, okay, I'm sort of having an advantage in producing product X somewhere to continue and try and develop means to get more efficient at that. Isn't that sort of innovation?
No. On the contrary, I think that the capitalists that follow the comparative advantage is nothing more than following what the demand is requesting. If my position in the world division of labor say that I have more capacity to satisfy the given demand in, for example, producing copper, the passive role of the capitalist is going to just produce copper and not innovate towards new sector where still the demand is not there. You know? So in that sense, actually, the capitalist is behaving in a passive way if they follow just the comparative advantages. There is a very interesting article called The Creative Response in Economic History, where Schumpeter tried to give some ideas about the creative response of capitalists and the passive response of capitalists. I think it would be very helpful for you.
So I think related to that is sort of how we're defining innovation. And so in Schumpeter's view, innovation would not just be lower price, but a whole new product.
Exactly. Right? It's basically, well, the innovation is not only developing one different product. For example, discovering a new market. Yeah. Colonialism is actually an innovation. Building a new productive process, a new productive unit. So the question in Schumpeter is, again, who's building it? You know? And Schumpeter, according to Schumpeter, the capitalist, the typical manager, the capitalist is unable to discover that process. They just respond to the given demand, and through the responding the given demand, is trying to compete, putting prices down. But there is nothing in the capitalist per se. If we assume it just as a person that maximizes utility, that can explain this psychological issue of innovating. Right?
So, I wonder what Schumpeter will say about Silicon Valley today. Mm-hmm. So, you have young people going to tech. If you look at the Forbes list of billionaires, a lot of people from Silicon Valley.
Yes.
So what would you say about that, and what's the next level? Because that's a change from the big old guy, that runs GE or something. Now you have these young guys doing stuff. But what's the next level? What's innovation going to be after Uber and Google and these guys who are becoming very big too? Like
quite interesting. Actually, it's a very good example with this idea that Schumpeter said. I mean, Schumpeter in the first part of his life, he said innovation comes from outside, comes from these like new firms that are trying to compete the big firms. But in the last period of his life, particularly in the book Capitalism, Socialism, and Democracy, he said, no, this has changed. Innovation now comes from within the firm. The big firms, the big monopolies, have the capacity and the resources to take the risk, in order to create new products. So that's why, for example, we can explain Silicon Valley or Google at these big monopolies, in the case of Google, but keeps innovating because they have endogenized innovation within the firm. So the next step, I don't know. I think that what I can tell you is that Schumpeter said there's not every monopoly is good. There are some monopolies that of course are rentier, takes advantage of the rents. But this process of monopolization, if they still have the capacity of competing, the competitive monopoly, if there is still that source of competition, is going to keep the process of innovation. The problem of that is that that is going, according to Schumpeter, to create a cultural delegitimation of the system.
How is the absorption of the entrepreneur into the firm any different than kind of the absorption of the individual worker into a factory? It almost seems to me that they're kind of the same process. So technically, the Marx argument and the Schumpeter argument, it's just that it seems to me to be happening at a later time. It almost seems to me to be ultimately the same critique of capitalism.
So you're saying that in the first part, the worker innovate?
Yeah, like the average worker who might be making shoes, that is then absorbed into a shoe factory. Yeah. But now, say Uber, or Google, who innovated a company. Now Google has absorbed individual coders or something. It almost seems to me that that's technically the same process.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't understand how that's a different argument about capital.
Okay. Yeah. Well, actually, Adam Smith made the same point that the workers also have this capacity to innovate in order to reduce the labor time. So they try to like innovate within the firm in order to reduce the necessary time for their work and have more free time. But I think that the function is the same. I mean, both agents, both like the worker or the big firm, are innovating. What changes is the process. In the competitive capitalist society that Schumpeter was talking about, the innovation was something that comes from outside the dominant firms. So for example, I'm producing the water. I have the big monopoly in the production of water, of bottles and so on. And there comes from outside a new a small firm that needed the money. That's the importance of the credit system. That needed the money and take the risk in discovering a new product that competes with me. So the innovation comes from outside, an alternative firm that is entering the market. Okay? While in the monopoly capitalism, again, the innovation is part of the firm. Is part of they hire people to innovate, workers to innovate. The role is the same. In the first, the innovator is the entrepreneur, the individual entrepreneur. But in the second example, the innovator is the worker. Okay, the role is the same, but what changes is the agent. Okay.
So, what would be like the relationship between, say, a sort of classicalist model that said like growth is fundamentally caused by exogenous technological change, and what Schumpeter would say? Is Schumpeter kind of describing the mechanism by which that would happen, or is there something fundamentally different between the
no.
two?
Yeah. No, changes come from within. I mean, it's not exogenously driven. On the contrary, it's through the own forces of competition that creates or give the incentive for this entrepreneur to discover new commodities through the access of the credit system. So it's not something, the key point here is that entrepreneurship or the process of innovation are not dependent on exogenous factors. Let's say changes in consumption possibilities, changes in culture and so on, but are the product of the market, is endogenous, are the product of their own capitalist system. Okay, so in relation to Solo, I would say that Schumpeter would try to say that no, innovation comes from within, from the own incentive of the capitalist system. And that explains why actually capitalism has this enormous capacity to innovate in relation to pre-capitalist society, or according to him, socialist economies.
So just on how the final stage of how capitalism, in his eyes, sort of self-destructs itself. Is it that the workers begin to demand more and more rights, and so socialism is inevitable from that? Can you go over the final stage of how it destroys itself?
Oh, yeah, sure. According to Schumpeter, and I think that hypothesis is his proof, but you have to think at his times. He was writing just after the Second World War. The idea of the Keynesian revolution was there. The idea of the social democracy taking the government was there. I mean, the idea of socialism as a possibility was very close, right? The welfare state and so on. So when Schumpeter saw that, he was trying to explain it. He was trying to explain how can this process of socialization be happening. And what Schumpeter said was that the reasons that he found was that capitalism is not stagnated. There's nothing like in the capitalist system that can say like we're entering into the big crisis that is going to create the revolution. No, the variable should be outside or should be another explanation. And what he found out or what he thought was that the problem and I'm going to repeat what I said, is that the own process of innovation is destroying the agents that could protect capitalism, like in the cultural field, in the political field. You know, the capitalists are, in some sense, financialized. They're becoming shareholders, and they're just in the process of buying and selling stocks. And they don't have any, according to Schumpeter, particular interest in defending, like, the monopoly of certain firms or not, as previous capitalists, you know, like when they owned the firm and they were, like, all their life was there in that firm. At the same time, capitalism destroyed certain allies, like the feudals, like the aristocracy, through the process of competition. And also, through the process of centralization and monopoly, it was destroying the small and medium enterprises, the small and medium bourgeoisie. And if you have experience with these, like, small and medium enterprises, you will see that the people are very into their firm. I mean, they put their life there, okay? So they are very supporters of that kind of economy. They are supporters of that kind of property relations. But the process of capitalism is also destroying them, as Marx also thought. So Schumpeter would say capitalism is not dying because of its economic contradiction, but it's because it's destroying the agents that can defend it in the political field. And at the same time, we have the process of politicization of the productive process, which the workers become like ask more things, you know, like more social rights and so on. So you have an agent that is getting strong and politicized, and the other side, the guy that could support them, are getting destroyed by themselves. I think that hypothesis, by the way, certainly it was disproved after the 70s. But this was a very clear hypothesis. I mean, even Marxist at that time, the Frankfurt School thought about that capitalism was going to be destroyed because of problems in the cultural sphere and not in the economic order, in the economic structure.
From what I understood, Schumpeter took the role of consumer in the circle of law as passive. But when I think about it, like, the consumers can, in a way, innovate economically in two ways. So one is basically cutting down their expenditure on whatever on goods they buy. And the second one is kind of setting the demand trends for luxury goods. So did he kind of talk about the interplay, that maybe there is an interplay, especially in luxury goods? I mean, there are some trends for cars, for clothes, for housing.
Yes.
Was that affecting entrepreneur?
No, I mean, I would support you, but I think what Schumpeter was saying is that the innovation that he was talking about were radical innovations. It's like the movement from railroads to cars, from cars to airplanes. Of course, there are small innovations. He also talked, and I couldn't because of the time, I couldn't explain, but there's also small innovation, a small process of change that can be explained because changing in the consumption patterns, you know, and there we can think about a more active consumer, right? But what Schumpeter was talking about was these, like, radical changes in the productive structure that cannot be explained, like the movement from the railway to the car. There was not, like, consumer demanding the car. There were just entrepreneurs that discovered this new market. Do I respond? Is it clear? Yeah.
I'm just curious. I've been researching the pharmaceutical industry quite a bit, and so a lot of these dynamics come. And I'm interested in the relationship now between big sort of oligopolies and smaller enterprises, where you see sort of the value chain where these big companies have almost become like the banks in a sense, because they're sort of the payoff for venture capitalists when they acquire the smaller companies. It's a bit of a different sort of. I wonder how we can understand sort of a capitalism in which you've got some big firms basically betting on smaller firms to do the innovation, and then these bigger firms sort of do the last stages.
I mean, I think that the issue of the global value chain literature has changed a lot, like the way that the process of innovation is developed. I'm not an expert in global value chain. I have two friends here that are specializing in those issues, but I think that innovation, the big firms try to take the innovation, keep the innovation, the process of innovation, like, from them, and they try to externalize the most, like, the less dynamic productive processes, or in Schumpeterian concept, the processes that are in the circular flow, and they try to keep the process of innovation. But there's been, like, I've also read that certain processes of innovation are, like, putting into small and medium enterprises, and they're articulated with this firm. So they also act as a monopoly, I mean, as a monopsony in that case. You know, like, they have to only sell to the firm. So in that sense, we can think about the new process of innovation through those lines, like the big firm becoming the monopsony and forcing the small and medium enterprise to sell the product just to them. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. you, Jose, for a very nice overview of Schumpeter's works. So before you go, this week's CSEP lecture is taking place tomorrow at 5:30 in Mill Lane Room 3, and it's on the future of the euro. And next week in Paper Zero, we'll be hearing from Anne Heno, which will give us an introduction to modern monetary theory. So I hope to see you next week, and thanks again to Jose.